The next approach is retrosigmoid. Retrosigmoid approach. In this, we are getting a very panoramic view of CP angle, and the door of entry will be postaural incision, and this is a corridor, and we are reaching the CP angle and also the medial two-thirds of internal acoustic canal. And we are in this, we are not at all going into the temporal bone structures. We are not touching the inner ear or the middle ear, so the hearing will be preserved. So we are getting a view of CP angle from the foramen magnum inferiorly to tendorium superiorly. Okay, and also by preserving the hearing. So the indications are tumors of CP angle of less than 3 cm with serviceable hearing. And also tumors with the minimal IAC, internal auditory canal invasion. Because we are getting access only to the medial two-thirds of internal auditory canal. So, if there is a complete extension of the internal acoustic canal, or if the fundus of the internal auditory canal, the lateralmost end is involved, we cannot go through this. In that case, it is better to go with a translabyrinthine approach. So, these are the indications of retrosigmoid. And this is a modification of the traditional suboccipital approach used by neurosurgeons for approaching the posterior fossa tumors. So what are the advantages of this approach? You know, the hearing is preserved. Hearing is preserved, that is the main advantage of this approach. And what are the disadvantages? From this you know that to get into the CP angle, we have to retract the cerebellum, isn't it? So retraction of the cerebellum or cerebral manipulation will be there more, and also the manipulation of the lower cranial nerves. So cerebellum and lower cranial nerve manipulation is more. So what will happen? There is more chance of postoperative chronic headache. In translabyrinthine approach, these were the advantages. Here it's a disadvantage. And also, what is the other thing? If the fundus is involved, we cannot access. Okay, we cannot access the fundus of internal acoustic canal. So access to internal acoustic canal fundus is limited. And also, what is the other thing? Can we reach the facial nerve easily? No. So there is, if at all there is injury to the facial nerve, if we want to do a grafting of the facial nerve, it will be difficult. So grafting of the facial nerve will be difficult. In case if there is an injury. Okay. So these are the disadvantages, and the main advantage is we can preserve hearing. First is positioning. Positioning supine with the head on a head ring or fixed with the neurosurgery clamps. And the important thing is the intermeatal line. This intermeatal line should be perpendicular to the floor so that the internal acoustic meatus will be in line with the external auditory canal. And this will help the surgeon to get a very good orientation of the internal acoustic canal. Okay. And after that, that is the incision. So the incision is either we can put a vertical incision or a curved incision, slightly curved backwards and going into the neck also. And the upper end should be almost in line with the zygomatic arch. Okay, so this is incision, After this, a 5 × 5 cm suboccipital craniotomy with the transverse sinus. The transverse sinus will be the upper limit and the sigmoid sinus will be the anterior limit. So approximately the craniotomy will come here. Okay. Suboccipital craniotomy with the sigmoid sinus as the anterior limit and the transverse sinus as the superior limit. So after putting craniotomy, next is incision of the dura. So then you can see the sigmoid sinus and also cerebellum. So before retracting the cerebellum, the CSF should be released from cisterna magna and release the CSF and then retract the cerebellum. We need a medial retraction of the cerebellum to get a very good view of CP angle. If there is involvement of the internal acoustic canal, then the posterior bone from the posterior wall of internal acoustic canal has to be drilled out. This area has to be drilled out so that we will get a very good view of the tumor, whether it is in the CP angle or in the internal acoustic canal. After that, tumor removal. As I have already told in translabyrinthine approach, either the very small tumors can be removed as such, or for comparatively larger tumors, the interior should be gutted using a laser or laser vaporization or aspiration with CUSA or with a micro cup. And after tumor removal, the closure should be there. So if I am comparing this with the translabyrinthine approach, the main advantage is that yes, the hearing is preserved. That is the main advantage, and also very good visualization of the CP angle is can be done using a this retrosigmoid approach. Okay, and the main disadvantages compared to the translabyrinthine, one is the access to the facial nerve is very much limited. If there is an injury, we cannot go for a easy grafting of the facial nerve, is not possible. And second, as we are not doing anything with the eustachian tube, so there is more chance of a postoperative CSF rhinorrhea. Okay, and also we are retracting the cerebellum, we are manipulating the cerebellum, so postoperative definitely there will be a postoperative chronic headache. So this is about retrosigmoid approach.